Hyderabad, it has problem. It reduces our cost of critical care only.
Good afternoon. Respected Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, it is my endeavor to tell you what actually the meaning of a life sciences and put into the perspective how it is affecting the healthcare system, what is the future of the India in that respect. Basically, life sciences is a dynamic industry. Life sciences involves anything which is dealing with the organisms, whether it is plant, whether it is animal, or the human beings. So whatever companies which are dealing with in the fields of biotechnology, pharmaceuticals, biomedical technologies, life systems, nutraceuticals, cosmetics, food processing, environmental, biomedical organizations which and institutions that devote the majority of their efforts in the various stages of research, development, technology transfer, and commercialization. If you cover up all these factors, you will come into what is the contribution of the life sciences to the industry. Now, if you have seen, during the 19th century and the 20th century, we have seen development in the form of isolation, identification, and finding out the causative agents or etiological agents of the various infective process diseases like cholera, typhoid, malaria, and other things of that nature. And as a result of the control and the elimination by vaccines and the discovery of antibiotics, we have come to a stage now where communicable diseases have more or less controlled or eliminated. Non-communicable diseases in the form of cardiovascular diseases, hypertension, stroke, diabetes, metabolic diseases like diabetes and cancer have taken the prime role and are main target of our focus as of in this century. Partly this is the result of the going to be the post-genomic era. I just want to go through a little bit of what life sciences innovation is going to affect the social and economic sector. They've got a profound impact on the economic life. These have resulted in the decoding of the genome and post-genomic era, when we try to manipulate the genome and try to understand how we can change between the choice and the chance. Next one, please. If you look at the current life sciences, what are all the evolved methodology in this one? One is the molecular biology, the second is the nanotechnology, the third is the stem cell technology, DNA sequencing, biological cell culture, cloning, DNA expression, RNA purification, and drug discovery. If you take all these modalities into a consideration, the future is going to be this one, next one. And industry as a comprehensive ecosystem, if you take it, as already it has been highlighted, we should have the enhanced patient expectations because the trust is going to be there. We should have the epidemiological changes whereby you have the bio surveillance, whereby you can get the, all the epidemiological data and the medical advancement in the form of a so-called invasive, minimally invasive and non-invasive procedures. And as in US, the more and more doctors are getting less, they have started the ambulatory care system, which is going to be the future for the patients who are to be treated. We can treat more patients and less by less number of doctors. So also, as has been already highlighted, there is enhanced regulation in the form of ethics and the NABH and other regulatory bodies. And so we are expected to have standards, new financing modalities like the priority equity, this one come, and PPP has already been alluded. Quality assessment by the various grades like the NABH and the healthcare evaluation. Now, how is it going to affect the life sciences in the present situation? We have to make available, as already been mentioned, one is the efficacy, second is the effectiveness, third is the accessibility, affordability, acceptability, economic merit of the innovation. These principles would indicate the potential of healthcare product, service, or innovation for the community, keeping in view of the ethical, social, and cultural impact of such medical innovations. The most important thing is the management of this innovation. It is a very critical thing. It has to be flexible. Multiple approaches are required. It is economic incentive for some, but it is a professional satisfaction for others. So during the design phase, there should be divergent thinking, creativity, brainstorming, administrative flexibility, and effective communication. During the implementation phase, there should be effective planning, coordination, control, evaluation, participatory decision making, and appropriate incentive. Now, what are we looking for? We should have a biosurveillance whereby you can have the either the electronic medical records or biometric sensors, population statistics, and environmental factors. We should now look at not in terms of a lifespan, but we should look at the health span, whereby people think whatever life they have spent is a better life than the number of years. And also, as I mentioned about the remote care, when more number of patients can be taken care in the areas by a small number of doctors. And we should also look at the future of the mental health, whereby mental, as the age advances, there will be patients with depressive disorders. They have to be separated from the bipolar disorders which are available. If you look at the what is this impact on the Indian health industry, unprecedented growth in the healthcare industry and easy and flexible treatment options from private equity, venture capital, and public-private partnership. The private and public sector across the various states have launched innovative initiatives to attract PPP interventions, has already been mentioned. Government is exploring potentials to establish state-funded healthcare insurance schemes, supporting healthcare delivery for poorer sections of the population. The corporate segment is catering to the growing need of the general public for quality care. Through a sustainable partnership, development, and delivery of low-cost, affordable, basic healthcare services, PPP models may help in improving the infrastructure, healthcare provisions of the country. Advent of medical value travel from far developed nations to India for high-end tertiary care work going to excellence of healthcare delivery. Technology advancement from open invasive procedure to minimally invasive, as I already mentioned, to non-invasive and hybrid facilities are going to be the future. we also look at the accurate diagnosis and therapeutic alternative. If you look at the health scenario, what are the challenges? Indian healthcare sector is one of the largest sectors with an estimated revenue $35 billion. India needs 1.75 million beds by 2025 to reach a ratio of 2 beds per 1,000 population. 0.7 million doctors are needed to reach a ratio of 1 to 1,000 population. Health insurance sector has not penetrated and has got a lot more scope to grow. As of now, only 2% of the total population is being insured at the present. Appropriate utilization of the new medical devices and technology in India and monitoring of the main factors underlying this approach has to be regulated. Sufficient regulations like the Medical Devices Act have to be formulated. What are the key developments in the rural healthcare sector during the last 5 years? 15,000 health sub-centers, 28,000 nurses and midwives are added. Primary health centers number increases by 84%. Health insurance premium is expected to grow by 25%. Medical tourism is predicted to be around 3% by 2013 and expected to generate $3 billion in revenue. Medical technology is going to reach by $14 billion by 2020. And computer-based biosurveillance projects generating the data about diseases and creating databases on the healthcare in rural areas. What are the government policies? The government, as of now, has permitted 100% FDA in the health sector. The National Rural Health Mission has allotted 10.15 billion in this fund by future 12th plan. An additional 1.23 billion have been allotted for the 6 upcoming AIIMS-like institutes and upgradation of the 13 existing medical colleges. Thank you very much.